kani kadai ka Batik CCTV bat pidang pet ya ka kubur baman kasni belawan rasa pi tak ko umrupa ringkat bat ko orange Nissan lom sokpo near Fabricate Shillong.
New Nissan Kicks bookings open now.
Ki kenta keli jing keli bala buk por tang si kenta hapok ke dorbar senrai jong ke ying dorbar tau an ke jela haka khat waiterik unai lor arjar khat kendai kalasaki tang ya ke jingya tai halor ke jing keli balawan rak dau MLA jong ke Mauplang constituency uba center class sun kabaya day bar ke hukum bala penjari daga National Green Tribunal haka khat nyutrik u yayong arjar khat sao kabala khang ya ke jing shalan banti bat ban shalan yau doyong na ke jela Meghalaya. Unia u MLA jangka Mauplang constituency ulabu jingkeliru yau Menteri Ketenat Mining and Geology bahato kat kumka hukum bala penmi dari Yang Bisha Supreme Court hau naitung arjar kat kendai laga day shishane em ka hukum bala ailat biang ya kejela Meghalaya ban beteng ya kejingti dauyong kat kum kikendon ain.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, the preamble to the July 3, 2019 Supreme Court judgment order in the matter of the state of Meghalaya versus all the Masa South Students Union says, and I quote, Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, natural resources of the country are not meant to be consumed only by the present generation of men or women of the region where natural resources are deposited.
Honourable Member, you come straight to your cushion.
I'm coming, sir. It's just two lines. Yeah. I'm coming to that. These treasures of nature are for all generations to come and for intelligent use of the entire country. The present generation owes a duty to preserve and conserve the natural resources of the nation so that it may be used in the best interests of coming generation as well as for the country as a whole. In this context, may I move from the Honourable Chief Minister the contention put forward by the state before the Honourable Supreme Court order on the matter, sir?
Sir, I think the particular issue that has been raised by the Honourable Member and obviously the preamble of the order that came out of the Supreme Court, I think is exactly what the government also is looking at. So the issue here that we face is how do we balance out between the economy and the ecology? And I think we understand that here we are looking at the issue of environment, the issue of natural resources, the issue of how we will manage these natural resources now and in the generations to come, so that these resources, which not only us but our future generations also have right to, how to be balanced. And that is the reason why, if you look at the entire the order that has come out, it is a very balanced order, I must say, and therefore it is respecting the rights of the tribals. It is respecting the fact that the ownership is with the tribals and with the land owners, and yet at the same time, different laws that have been put in are there to ensure that all these activities of mining, which are leading to economic activity, livelihood, revenue for the state, is achieved, but at the same time, it should not be done in an irresponsible manner. It should be done in a manner in which there is a scientific approach to it and controlled approach to it, and keeping in mind the environmental aspects. So that is what the whole contention was, and that is how it has moved forward. And the order of the Supreme Court, as I said, the Honorable Supreme Court is a very balanced order, sir.
Whether it is a fact that the Supreme Court in its judgment has relied heavily on the need to protect the environment, and in the process has upheld in letter and spirit all actions taken by the NGT, asserting that the tribunal relied on several ground research, including that of Dr. O.P. Singh of Nehru, which speaks of acid mine drainage amongst other environmental damages caused by the coal mining, including reports of the State Pollution Control Board.
Sir, I think again this is exactly what our point is, and I think I would like to thank the Honourable Member for really understanding and really bringing out these issues which would allow the people to understand the balance of economy and ecology. And yes, I think the fact that there has been a lot of consideration on the environmental aspect, the Supreme Court has said that the soil and the subsoil belongs to the people, yet in order to conduct the mining, you must clear other, apart from other clearances and compliances, the Environmental Protection Act 1986 also has to be followed. So therefore, obviously, there has been a lot of stress on environment.
Is it also a fact, sir, that the Supreme Court in its order concludes that there is nothing in the sixth schedule of the Constitution which any manner exclude the applicability of MMDR Act 1957 in the tribal areas of Hill District of the state of Meghalaya?
So can I just repeat that question? Sorry.
Is it also a fact that the Supreme Court in its order concludes that there is nothing in the sixth schedule of the Constitution which in any manner exclude the applicability of MMDR Act 1957 in the tribal areas of Hill District of the state of Meghalaya?
Sir, I think again it's very important, I just will take about 30 seconds to point this out again, that there are two factors or two issues that we're looking at. One is regarding the ownership of the coal and who owns this coal and who owns the land. And the second issue is a procedural issue of what are the preventions, precautions and compliances that you have to follow. So I think it is important not to mix the two. Now, what is happening here, sir, is that the fact that it's a sixth schedule area and the fact that we have got our tribal rights and certain ways and customary practices, based on that and the arguments which went on for hours and hours, you know, we got the order that says that sixth schedule areas have been respected. Respected in the sense that the ownership of the soil and the subsoil belongs to the landowner. That is where the respect to the tribals and to the sixth schedule has been given. But at the same time, keeping in mind the issues that were mentioned by the Honourable Member in his first question, that whether the environmental issues are important or not, therefore the MMDR Act, which requires mining plans to be put in into place, which have to be cleared by RQPs and other authorized agencies, is being mentioned. So therefore, yes, even in the sixth schedule area, though the ownership is not affected, but the procedure with which you will follow and do the mining has been prescribed by Government of India in order to take care of the issues which you had mentioned in your first point, which is the environment and other things like the safety of the miners. So this is the difference between the two.
So, as per the Supreme Court order, if mining operations are undertaken in privately owned, community-owned land in Meghalaya, in accordance with mining lease, with approved mining plan as per Act 1957 and Mineral Concession Rule 1960, the ban order dated 17/4/2014 of the Tribunal of NGT shall not come in the way of mining operations. May I know who is the agency responsible for preparation of mining plan as well as agency responsible for approval of mining plans?
So the process is very long, but of course I'll just, I mean explanation is long, so I'll try to really be very concise. So basically the landowners or the people who are planning to mine it, the landowners, so they will have to prepare the mining plan, but this mining plan will have to be prepared by certain agents, not agencies, sir, but by the recognized qualified persons, which is notified by Ministry of Coal under Rule 22 of the Mineral Concession Rules Act. And there are 86 such RQPs who are there. So using these RQPs, the individuals who plan to do the mining will have to apply to Government of Meghalaya for the mining plan. I'm telling you, there are 3, 4, 5 other things to be done, but since you asked only for the mining plan, I'm just telling you mining plan. Once these RQPs have prepared the mining plan and submitted to Government of India, Meghalaya, Government of Meghalaya will further send it to the Coal Ministry. And the coal ministry has got a committee which is headed by the secretary, and other people like the DGMS, Coal India, Environment and other agencies are part of this committee, which is the committee which will ultimately give the approval of this mining plan and send it back to the government of Meghalaya.
No. My last question, sir. Since the Autonomous District Council are now deprived of the power to make any law with regard to granting of mining lease, but private owner, community owner of the land, who is also the owner of the minerals, now have the rights to grant lease for mining of coal in Akadanmu Chapter 5 of Rules 1960. May I know if the same could also be made applicable to mining of uranium in the tribal areas of the state?
Sir, I think this is a different subject altogether. We are here talking about the coal. So therefore, in regards to uranium mining, sir, I'll require notice, or the honourable member can write a separate question on that, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir. In the course of reply of the Honourable Chief Minister, I could hear 86 RQPs. This, I don't know the short form. What is the full form of this abbreviation? I would like to know the full form.
Sir, the RQPs stand for Recognized Qualified Person.
Sir, from the replies of the Honorable Chief Minister, we could understand that there are lots of complications as far as this mining plan and clearance from the ministry is concerned. So, but then, sir, recently there was some felicitation program organized in South Garo Hills, and the Honorable Chief Minister was claiming that the operation of the mining is restored and is the victory of the state of Meghalaya. So I would like to get the clarification from the Honorable Minister, because we are made to know that the operation of mining will be free now. But then again, from the replies of the Honorable Chief Minister, it is being known that it is very complicated and our people will be deprived of these facilities.
Sir, number one is that the felicitation program was organized by the people. So it is not something that I would like to comment on. If the people wanted to felicitate, that is something that is not something that I have the proper authority to comment on right now. But apart from that, sir, the issue that has been raised by the Honorable Member, I think it's a good opportunity, sir, to explain this entire issue out here, sir. So the people of the state and, you know, the in general, the coal miners especially, and the state government also, so it has been suffering from this ban for a very long time. So this issue of the ban has got multiple areas of concern. When it started off, sir, it started off as a ban on the environmental issue. It was regarding the Masa students who had mentioned about the rivers getting polluted. And once that issue took up and NGT put the ban, then other issues like safety of miners came into the picture. After that, the issue of ownership of the coal came into the picture. Does the coal nationalization policy apply? Does the coal belong to the people or does it belong to the government? And so therefore, it became a very complex problem, and that is the reason why when we went to coal ministry said talk to environment. When we went to environment ministry, they said call to talk to DGMS. When we talked to DGMS, they say we don't know about this. Unless coal moves, we can't do anything. So there was a very big confusion, and that is the reason why things became very complicated. So therefore, sir, there was a necessity created for us to move, or at least take a decisive step on how we should approach this problem. So we as a government, when we took over, we felt that the number one issue, because we analyzed all these three, four aspects, which is the environment issue, the mining safety issue, and the ownership issue. We looked into all these aspects and realized that ownership most probably is the most important aspect for us, apart from other things also. And therefore, if the ownership is not there, we will not be able to move into other areas. So therefore, we created and we worked towards ensuring that a proper argument was built around this particular issue. At the same time, obviously, trying to ensure that as many provisions of the MMDR Act as possible should be also relaxed for us, based on, as was mentioned yesterday, based on the 6th schedule para 12AB, that it could be provoked and it could be, you know, we could be exempted from certain provisions of the MMDR Act. So all those things were also going on. But sir, what happened when the Supreme Court ruling came out, it was really an historic judgment, sir. And I think that's the reason why the people were very happy. That the people have been told in a crux, sir, now I'll just summarize what I had said. In a crux, sir, the order has very clearly stated, most importantly, that the coal ownership is with the owner of the land. That means the soil and the subsoil belong to the people. I think that itself is a victory of the people. And I think that has cleared a lot of the confusion that was lying, you know, for the past many years. So I think that was the number one point for the celebration part. So number two, the Supreme Court also said that, and I think Supreme Court, Honorable Supreme Court, is right in its order, saying that if the individuals comply to certain rules, the ban will not be applicable. So therefore, sir, I think it was very important, as I said, I thank the Honorable Member from Moplang who had brought out this issue, that if you look at the preamble of the order, it very clearly states that we are custodians, but it's our job also to ensure that this resources not just belong to us, but it belongs to the future generation. And that is why, sir, to clear the Honorable Member from Rangsakona's you know, apprehensions, that it is a victory for us because it has paved a way forward on how we could move. Things were stuck. There was a lot of confusion. I think the system has been set in order. The processes have been defined. And now at least we can move forward in a positive manner. But having said that, what Supreme Court's order says is that you can't take the rivers for granted. You can't take the miners for granted. You cannot take the coal also for granted, and then therefore there must be a systematic way and a scientific way which protects the miners and protects the environment to ensure that mining also takes place, but at the same time the safety of the environment and the safety of the miners also is there. So I think it's not it would not be proper for us to confuse this whole situation. Having said that, the order says is very clear, as I said, number one. And number two, even as a society and as a state, I think it is about time that we move on, we move to move forward, realizing that it is our responsibility. In the past, yes, we were mining in the ways you know, we felt was most convenient to us, was cutting the cost for us, was most profitable for us, which is fine, as a business individuals did it. But I think there comes in a time where we need to see that we are not only responsible for our business, but for the society as a whole. And that is why today this order is very clearly stating that provisions of the Environmental Protection Act and the MMDR Act and all these provisions are done not to stop or not to make you know, this mining difficult process for the miners, but to ensure that our environment and our miners who are working the mines are protected and are safe. So I think it should be very clear, sir. These are very two different issues. Of course, connected. I'm not saying they're disconnected. They are connected. But it's important to see them in their perspective, sir. So I hope that gives some clarity to the Honorable Member.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I'm still a bit confused because the Honorable Chief Minister, during the felicitation program, he didn't specify that only the land surface and the subsoil now belongs to the people of the state, the landowner. But also he has said that the operation of the mining is open now. It's a victory. So our people who has been suffering for not being able to mine will be able to mine now. So I don't know why the Honorable Chief Minister, inside the house his version is different and outside the house is different, because whenever Chief Minister speaks a word, it's taken to be a gospel truth. So it's very important, sir. So I would like to get clarification from Honorable Chief Minister whether he is intentionally being double standard, or actually is it just because of the situation he speak in different way by which it was leading to the misleading to the people of the state.
Sir, I think my statements have been very, very uniform in all the platforms that I've been talking. And I've been very clear to the people of the state that, you know, the coal mining, as I said, the lifting of the ban is lifted in the sense, as it is written by the order, that shall not come in the way. Sorry, the word is shall not come in the way. The NGT ban shall not come in the way. And coal mining can take place provided you follow different procedures and different laws and you are comply to the different provisions of different laws. So there's been no change in my statement. I've been stating it very clearly in all the fronts. I have had separate meetings even with the coal miners when they came to me. I specifically told the coal miners who came to me, please remember that yes, it is a victory for the people because the ownership has been restored to you. But remember that the mining process and procedure will be different. You have to follow certain processes, and if you follow those processes, you'll be able to mine. So I think that my statement has been uniform, sir, and I have not changed my statement at all. But then if there is any more clarification that Honourable Member wants, I'm happy to give, sir.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir. So if we look at the reply of the question, a reply given by Honourable Chief Minister. So here, actually, Chief Minister should not say that does not arise in view of A above. Because Honourable MLAs have asked the question whether the right of the tribal to mine the minerals lying below the surface of his land has been restored as well in the past. Actually, the reply should be no, sir, because of the MMDR Act 1957. Because in the judgment of the Honourable Supreme Court, is very clear, sir. This is your land. This is your national resources. This is everything is belong to you. But you have to take a permission from MMDR Act. So regarding with this, I have a question. Because for the long time, sir, we know that all the land in the tribal area, especially in Khasi, Jaipur, and Garo, it belong to the district council. My question, sir, to Honourable Chief Minister, what is the role of the district council regarding with the present situation of mine in our state, sir?
Sir, I think the Supreme Court order has been quite clear. First, sir, let me get back to first the concerns of the Honourable Member for the answer that was given in B. So that is exactly what it means. The fact that if you look at the overall above the above answer in A, and you look at the question in B, it is mixing two parts which I've already said, sir. There is a part of restoration of the ownership, but the process that is to be followed is something that is prescribed by the Supreme Court. So therefore, these are the areas which the individual miners will have to go through. But part of the answer to that is a yes, and a part of the answer to that is a no, because of the fact that it cannot be done in the way it was done in the past, and which is a clear fact which we've been mentioning and saying from day one. So therefore, just wanted to clarify that aspect of the order. The second issue that has been coming out regarding the district council, sir. So the district council are the custodians in one way, sir. The landowners are there, but the custodian of the whole thing and how to, you know, the different laws that are made by the district council in regards to the land ownership and all these aspects are something that is not something where we are interfering, or neither is the Supreme Court interfering, sir. Here the Supreme Court is simply saying that the procedure for the mining leases, for the mining plan and the prospective mining, the process has been defined in which they have to apply to the state government, and the state government will further send it to the concerned agencies, sir. So therefore, there is a very clear demarcation of this, and I don't think there's any confusion in that, sir.
So why am I asking regarding with the district council? Because in the court order, hopefully mentioned that there is no mention of the word district council, that the coal miners in a state again with resume of the mining, they have to take a permission from district council. The role of district council has not mentioned anything in the order of Supreme Court. That's why, sir, I would like to ask the Chief Minister if that will be the reply of the Chief Minister. It should be very clear now if the mine after the coal miners would like to mine for the coal in his own respective areas, whether they have to take permission or whether the coal miners have to take permission or not from the city council, because MMDR Act does not mention that coal miners have to go to the city council straight. Straight to the government. Government will send the paper cement to Delhi, sir.
Sir, as I've mentioned again, that regarding the ownership of the land and issues that are required with ownership, if there are certain aspects of the district council, that is something that the Supreme Court has not mentioned. So therefore, those issues and those areas continue as they are. But when it comes to the procedure of actually applying for the mining lease or mining plan, the Supreme Court has very clearly mentioned that the state government will be the agency where they'll apply, and the Supreme Court and the government of Meghalaya will further send it to the national agencies, whether it's environment, whether it's Coal India, whether it's DGMS, to get the necessary clearances. So that is how it will be, sir.
Another question, sir. So again, sir, reply number 52C. Honourable Member have mentioned whether coal mining in the state has been resumed. The answer C does not arise in view of the B. Actually, the answer said no. My question to Honourable Chief Minister, when do we expect that coal mining will be resumed back in our state, sir?
Sir, as I had mentioned, that it is a very, very process that has been defined. And before the Supreme Court order came out, there was a big confusion and complication in the entire process of how we should proceed. You know, as I said again, I'm repeating, sir, for the benefit of the Honourable Member, that when we went to the Coal Ministry asking them for certain things, they said, well, DGMS has to come in. When we went to DGMS for something, then they would say, well, get the environment clearance. When we went to Environment Ministry, they would send us to Home Ministry. So like that, there was a big confusion regarding the entire mining on how we should move forward, simply because there were multiple departments and multiple agencies and multiple Government of India departments that were involved out here. What this has done today is it has clarified on how we should proceed. Now we know where we are going to start and how we're going to move forward. And that is why, after this ownership issue has been restored, now the miners will have to individually, you know, go through these RPQs and apply for the mining plan. Of course, sir, there's a procedure for it. If you give me a minute or so, I'll just give a small explanation to that also. That there has to be a prospective mining plan which has to be first passed. This again has to be done at the state government. They have to apply. Then after that, they will apply for the mining plan. Once the mining plan is applied for, which will be prepared by these RQPs, it will be sent to Government of India. And then there's a committee that sits there, and then they will pass this. After that is done, they'll come back to the state government, and then the mining lease will be taken up. And for the mining lease, there'll be 3-4 provisions which are there, which needs to be considered. I don't want to go into details of that, though I have it with me. But after the mining lease has been confirmed, it'll again go to Government of India, Coal Ministry, for clearance and for approval. And of course, there's a mine opening permission which has to be done online through the Coal Controllers Organization. And then of course, there's approval that has to be taken from DGMS for the mining safety. So therefore, the procedure will take place. But as I said, yes, it's not easy, sir. Yes, there are procedures, because as I said, today, this government, the world today realizes and recognizes the importance of environment. Here, we have come out with a process where mining will be allowed, but procedure has to be followed. Earlier, the case was, you just can't move forward. Is there a ban? Is there not a ban? Is it through Coal Ministry? Is it through state? Is the state going to do it? Somebody is going to do it? Nobody knew what's the procedure. We were stuck. But today, we know how to move forward, and that is what this order has allowed us to do. And that is why we are saying that the process is now open and we can move forward, but rules have to be adhered to.
Shall we come to the rule?
Sir, please, may I have a clarification as well?
Can I just mention one thing? I have no problem, sir, in answering all the questions. But I think, sir, like in Parliament, we do keep a specific time for questions. And today we have spent 30 minutes on this question. I'll be happy if it comes in a motion or short discussion also. But sir, it's your wisdom. I'm ready to reply. But 30 minutes is quite a lot in one question, sir.
Honorable Deputy Speaker, sir, I would like
one clarification.
Sir, in reply to the principal's question at A, the Honorable Chief Minister has said that all rulings of the Honorable Green Tribunal shall not come in its way of carrying mining operations. May I inquire from the Honorable Chief Minister, is rat hole mining specific for the mining practices of the people of the state, particularly in Meghalaya?
No, I don't exactly understand the question which ma'am is asking, honourable member is asking.
May I therefore further clarify,
yeah.
Sir? Now, coal, the mining of coal in the state of Meghalaya is a peculiar style of operation. It was called rat hole mining. Are we now given the impression, therefore, that rat hole mining shall also or may also be permitted once the FQPs approve the procedure?
So I think the Honourable Member has replied to her own question. The thing is that rat hole mining has been a contentious issue, sir, and all the different agencies have questioned, about the safety and the environmental aspect and safety to the miners aspect of the rat hole mining. And therefore, this word rat hole mining has become, kind of a very contentious issue. But having said that, sir, I'm happy to inform you that there are many other locations in the country as well as the world which have similar seams that we have, which means 1 feet, 2 feet of coal deposits. There are such mines, and there are agencies and there are miners who are mining coal from there with the approval of Coal India, Ministry of Coal. My point being, sir, that I can of course not say which mine, which technology will apply, but the technological aspect and the mining aspect on what can be approved and allowed and not allowed is an area which the Coal Ministry, headed by the Secretary of Coal, will ultimately approve. So therefore, the word rat hole mining is one word we can use. A lot of people have started using the word tunnel mining. Now, therefore, we know that the seams, because I understand the concerns of the Honourable Member, that any kind of technology which we have outside in other parts of the world will not apply here because of the seams that we have. Therefore, in order to address her concerns and the concerns of all our people, what I'm trying to express now is tell people that there are mines like ours where technology which has been approved by the Coal Ministry are being applicable, and whether we use the word rat hole mining or tunnel mining, because tomorrow rat hole mining word could continue, but the rat hole mining might say that, well, the rat or the whatever the mechanism which we're going to use are going to be robots, are going to be machines. So the word rat hole mining might still continue, but it might be some kind of a technology which maybe it might be a robot rat, that might go in and get the coal. So therefore, the nomenclature is not something that is important out here. I think what is important is the technology that will be used and the mechanism which will be used, which will be approved by the Coal Ministry, sir.
I want to thank the Honourable Deputy Speaker, sir, please. It's my query is not yet fully satisfied. I would thank the Honourable Chief Minister for having understood that the coal locations in our state are different from others. Now, why was this question of rat hole such a contentious issue? I would like to know whether the government of Meghalaya has taken into consideration that the rat hole mining method was probably the only method that these small mine owners could access. Now the point here is, if we do change the provisions of how or what technology will be used or what terminology you're going to be assigning to the method of mining, where does the owner stand? in all of this? Can he still afford a mining lease? Can he still afford to hire the FQPs? What about the lease documents of to be signed between the landowners and these people? These are the obvious questions that will fall out from this entire new approach. May I know what is the mind of the government? Are we protecting the indigenous people and the fact that they own very small areas of land?
So multiple questions have been asked. So if I may,
unfortunately, because of the time constraints, so yeah, I clubbed them all because they were all connected, sir.
So I will take 10 minutes to reply to what she just said, sir. So please allow me, because I would like to clarify and satisfy the honourable member in terms of what she said. So the first thing, as was mentioned, regarding the rat hole mining that we had mentioned here, sir. So we all understand, and I think in the previous reply that I gave, I mentioned that rat hole mining is an issue which has been really, you know, discussed, and was one of the problems that we faced when this whole issue of the ban came in. And you know, this was mainly to do with the safety of the miners. So DGMS has really raised this issue and concern many times. Having said that, sir, I understand that a lot of our people have been doing rat hole mining for all these previous years. But sir, as the years have gone, different technologies have come in. And though, yes, I agree that our miners, some of them, and I should say most of them, are very small-time miners, you know, who are not able to financially maybe look into it or may not have the necessary connections to go and approach these RQPs. The point being that ultimately there are concerns at a larger scale, sir. And I think the honourable member will also agree with me when we say that, yes, you know, in the overall better interest of the state, in the overall better interest of society, of the environment, of the miners, certain procedures need to be followed. It's not the easiest thing to do. I agree, sir. It's not the easiest thing to do. But does that mean that the government turns a blind eye, the Honorable Supreme Court turns a blind eye to the environmental issues, to the safety issues? So therefore, here we are in a position now where the Supreme Court has, as I said, you know, Honorable Supreme Court has really addressed the main concern, which has been the ownership of the coal. And that has led the way for us to ensure that we can do the mining, but then keeping the general interest of the globe, I should say, the earth, Mother Earth as a whole, where we need to ensure that certain environment issues need to be protected. Yes, we need to follow certain procedures. And that is why it is important that the mine is open, the ownership has been given to the people, but procedures have to be followed. So that's number one. So number two, I would like to again stress that when it comes to issues like this, now there are many options in this world. Last week or about 10 days back, the government of India has even allowed FDI of 100% in the coal industry. And this is again a way that has paved the way forward, and maybe an opportunity, sir, I should say. Maybe an opportunity for our people where we might be able to go for partnerships in the future. And there are many, as I said, organizations, many individuals, many mining agencies, companies that have been engaging different levels of technology to ensure that mining can take place even with the kind of geographical and the topographical and the seams that we have, which are there in other parts of the country also. Not everywhere, but there are certain places where we have them. And mining is taking place out there with the approval of DGMS and Coal India, of Coal Ministry. And therefore, it's not that, you know, it's impossible. So it is possible and it is happening. And I would encourage, in fact, that our miners should, the time has come now, that now finally an opportunity is being given that yes, we can continue with the mining, but the issue of compromising with the ownership of the, with the environment and the mining plans and the safety of the miners is something that I think all the people and the citizens of the state also will agree is something that we should not compromise with. We've been talking about environment at such a big level throughout the world, and I think today it is up to us, the members sitting here, and in fact we need to ensure that we give importance to the environmental aspect. And that is why, yes, it is going to be not as easy as was mentioned, but these are things that we need to do to ensure that our people are protected, I mean our environment is protected. But at the same time, I said it's not that it's a closed door. There are many such technologies available today, and there are many places in the country and the world where this technology is being implemented. And tunnel mining based on technology which is very safe for the environment and for the miners is taking place today. So that's the first part of the question. Second part of the question, which honorable member mentioned, was regarding the lease. How do we go about it? So there is a different level which goes into actually clearing the lease part. And if you look at the entire process, as I mentioned, there's a prospective part, then there's a mining plan part, then there's a mining lease part, sir. So for the mining lease part, and for the satisfaction of the honorable member, the process will be that once the mining lease documents are prepared, they submitted to Government of Meghalaya. Once it is given to Government of Meghalaya, the forest clearances as per the Forest Conservation Act will be applicable. And then once this clearance has been given, then the environment clearance under the Environment Protection Act will be also taken into consideration. And if it is an area that is above 150 hectares, then it has to go to MOEF for this, for the clearances, environment clearances. And then after that, a consent to operate under the Air Act of 1981, Water Act of 1974, from the Pollution Board will have to be done. Once that is done, sir, the state government then further sends the proposal to the Government of India. And once Government of India Coal Ministry approves that, then the mining lease is again given back to the owner to execute the mining lease at their level, sir. So therefore, as I said, all these processes are defined. And from our side, sir, we have, last few months, the department has been working overtime to ensure that these things are structured and brought in place. Whenever such new things do happen, whenever the Supreme Court comes out with different kind of orders, government has to then again accordingly prepare itself to ensure that the people get the service. So the government has been working out different mechanisms. We do intend to have experts who will give the necessary training and sensitization to the mine owners. So all these aspects have been looked at, and as I said, the most important thing to remember, sir, is that now the procedure has been laid out. At least we have a way forward, and that is what it is. And in all that aspect, the interest of the miners is always kept in mind. From the government side, we will do everything to ensure that our people get the support they need, but keeping in mind that there are procedures and rules that need to be followed, keeping in mind the larger interest of the society, keeping in mind the larger interest of miners, and keeping in mind the environment and our globe as a whole, all these issues of global warming and all these issues. So obviously, sir, there's a responsibility we have at one side towards the environment and the miners. At the same time, we have a responsibility towards our coal miners, the industry, to ensure that livelihood is also protected. So we are trying to balance both these out and trying to find a way forward.
Now, enough has been discussed.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, it's a very important question. You are talking about the ramification of a very important judgment by the Honorable Supreme Court pertaining to the coal mining in the state, which is the engine of growth, source of income, employment, source of revenue. So let me put some questions. I heard that CM was saying...
One supplementary question to you.
Five supplementaries and total for me. And now, CM has taken enough time to reply. Enough time. In fact, the whole time is consumed by his narratives. It was not to the point. Now, let me come.
Sir, I think this is not correct.
No, it's very important. Let me put the question.
To put this.
Let me put the
number
question.
One, sir, the members have been saying that they want clarity. So it is my duty to give the clarity. And I think if I give clarity on
yes,
the issue, I don't think
that
comments like this should be made, sir.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, now replies to question number 52A. The reply indicates the status. Now, may I know from the Honorable CM in the first instance, with the judgment of this Honorable Supreme Court pertaining to this case, what is the status of Mines and Mineral Policy 2012 of the state government?
So the mines and mineral policy obviously is still applicable, but certain provisions, which of course I don't have details of right now, but the provisions accordingly will have to be adjusted. But then all this, the MMDR Act which we have, will be applicable, sir.
Now, if it has to be applied in a modified form, whether state government has taken measures to expeditiously complete this exercise, keeping in mind illegalities going on all across the mining area, to ensure that legal mining starts. If you don't start legal mining, illegal mining will continue. Therefore, what measures in respect of, if there is a need for modifying this Mines and Mineral Policy 2012 have been done, when was the meeting held to at least have this Mines and Mineral Policy amended, and what is the status?
Sir, we have been having multiple meetings. I can assure you.
Specific to this, Mines and Mineral Policy.
Well, I don't have the exact date with me, because there's so many things were there, sir. But I don't have the exact date with me, but we're moving very fast. I can assure the House, sir, that we're moving more expeditiously than the previous government. I can assure you.
See, this is very important, Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir. Even last night, there was a media in Assam carrying, showing in the electronic media, number of trucks dumping coal from Meghalaya. It's the same for the state. Same for us. And that is there. There should be a response. Therefore, the timeline for ensuring that the legal mining starts becomes very, very important. Now, therefore, we can understand that no step has been taken for taking corresponding action to facilitate expeditious mining. There is one what we can understand from the reply.
Sir,
another one is pertaining to the reply A.
Can I reply to his point, sir?
No, that is not a question.
You cannot give a speech out here. So let me tell you specifically.
You have given speeches.
You also gave the speeches from here before.
Now let me refer to
point A. Sir, let him ask a question specifically. Let me tell you, if he is saying that what has been happening for the past 1 year, why isn't things being moving expeditiously? I want to ask, what happened in the last 5 years? Why didn't we move in the past 5 years expeditiously? When finally we have moved forward, I think everybody should be happy about it. But here, for some reason, if Honorable LO is saying that in the last few days, all these things have been happening, I don't know what was happening in the last 5 years. Details can be given, sir, in the last 5 years what was happening. So therefore, I don't think it's incorrect for the Honorable LO to mention these kind of things when he himself realizes that in the last 5 years he struggled to get this through. It's a tough situation. But then our government worked overtime and we were very firm, we were decisive, we went ahead, and finally we're in a position where things are finally coming in order. I think the Honorable LO as well as the opposition should understand this and work together to ensure that we can move forward, because this is not in the interest of individuals, but in the interest of the state and the people.
Okay. Thank you for the reply. Thank you for the reply.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I think, I would like to put things straight. I think from 2003 till today, this is the first time that one question, we are about to complete 1 hour. So, sir, please, I would like to request you, please, don't allow all this. Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, let me just tell you, in fact, we have enough opportunities as per rules. Why don't you bring special discussion, or why not you bring in the form of short discussion? And you can take your times. There's no problem. But this is the question ours, as I said to you, sir. Now so many important questions we could not even dispose it of. I think this is not fair.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, the question hour is still there. So my another question is, now if we look at a judgment, the private land owners, the community is the owner of the land. That is part of the judgment of this Honorable Supreme Court. And may I know from Honorable Chief Minister, whether in view of this ruling of the judgment, his reply at 52A is correct in as far as the mining lease to be given by the state government is concerned. Is it correct?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. Can you repeat it?
See, the reply here says that the Honorable Supreme Court order, in its order dated 3rd July 2019, held that in event mining operations are undertaken by tribals or other owners of hills districts of Meghalaya in accordance with mining lease obtained from the state of Meghalaya. Who is to give this mining lease? In as far as the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court is concerned, in respect of mines under the land which is owned by the tribal or the community.
Sir, I think we are clear in our standing. Then Supreme Court has also been very clear that the mining lease ultimately has to be approved by Government of Meghalaya and approved by the Government of India. And only once the approval is obtained from us, then the mining lease can be executed by the owner.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, that is the problem. Now, it reflects how much homework the CM has done. It reflects how the government has done their homework. Whether it is mining lease or mining plan, you look at the paragraph 130 of the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. It's very clear. That's why I am saying that this government is not serious to start legal mining. Once you allow illegalities to happen, because it suits their intent.
Sir, I think let's compare last 5 years and let's compare the last 1.5 years. I think we know whose intent was what. I don't have to say.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, let's reply to that paragraph 130.
He's not allowing you to complete.
Please reply to that.
I don't know when he's saying. I don't know why he's getting so frustrated about this. But the point is, sir, when he's questioning the government's intent, we can see clearly that in the last 5 years, nothing moved, nothing happened. There was no intention of the government.
I'll tell about that.
There was no intention of the government to move anything.
I'll tell about that.
But today, we have got a decisive victory out here, decisive order from the Supreme Court saying that we can move ahead with the mining provided the policies and the different rules are obtained. So I think this
is
not very clear.
I have put a reply, Mr. Speaker.
Sir, they have not asked for any questions.
I have said, in respect of this reply, I am saying that this reply is wrong. Is it a fact that this reply is wrong? In view of the para 130 of the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court.
Sir, the 130 para is not with none of me right now, but I've been very clear in my...
I'm giving you. You must
be having the fight. I've been very clear in my statement where I've said the mining lease, the approval has to be obtained from the state government and the approval has to be obtained from the central government. And once the state government gives the approval of and obtains and these individuals obtain the approval, then only the lease can be executed. Now, sir, there are different aspects. Now, the LOAs, of course, he might not be aware of all these facts, but there is a different aspect of the prospective, the mining plan, and the mining lease. So there are three different aspects, and these three different aspects have to be seen separately, sir.
So we come to question number 53. Deputy Chief Minister is to reply.
What was the stand of the Union Government which was filed in the Honorable Supreme Court in the form of affidavit? That MMDR Act and Coal Mines Nationalization Act shall not apply in respect of Meghalaya as far as coal mining and lignite is concerned. That is the offshoot of the work of our government at that point of time. And you messed it up. And you are asking questions.
Sir, let me again, since Honorable LO has put this question, that the order of the coal ministry to give the exemption from these two provisions was given in 2015. They had the opportunity to work till 2018. 3 years. Once that order came out in 2015, nothing happened. So who messed it up? Did we mess it up or did you mess it up?
The Ministry of Coal doesn't work alone. The whole stand of the government is not considered by only one particular ministry. That was the reason. Now, what was the reason why, after the affidavit was filed, why the government could not prevail upon this?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, yeah. Reply to state question 53, sir. A, yes, sir, the gate is in existence. B, no, sir. C, sir, does not arise in view at B above. And D, sir, does not arise in view at B above.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I'd like to ask
the Honorable Minister reply on 53B, sir, it's not factual. Because I have a document here, sir, I'll have to speed up my question also. We have no more time. So I have a document here, rather a report, which states that this road, Happy Valley to Maushubut, connecting Sweet Falls also, is very much in the books of the PWD. Because there is a sanction order here, sir, 10-year sanction, which was accorded in 1984. And this road, the construction started in 1984 and was completed in 1985. And similarly, sir, again, there was another sanction in the year 1992, amount of 15 lakhs, sir. So, sir, I don't, the reply of the minister, oh, sir, is very confusing, stating that this road is not in the books of the PWD. And, sir, the answer to see, when was the road last repaired? So I would say that this road is repaired very regularly, except for a certain portion, the stretch of 3.30 kilometer is repaired regularly. So if you go to this road, which starts from Happy Valley to Maushubon, there are four defense establishments. The Assam Rifles, the Assam Regiment, the 58 Gurkhas and the Signals. The only stretch which is not repaired by the PWD is the stretch which falls under the 58 Gurkhas, which is about 250 meters. And sir, the reply to D, sir. Sir, here the question is, government has taken any concrete action? The reply is no, sir. Sir, there is a report where the Deputy Commissioner, P.S. Dakhar, in 2016 November, has had a meeting with the Army defense officials along with the PWD, and a report also has been submitted by the PWD to the Deputy Commissioner. So it clearly shows that the government has taken steps to resolve this issue. So this gate has been a problem to the residents of Maushubut, and so in the near future, with whatever is happening across the country, the terrorist strikes in Kashmir, in Pathankot and elsewhere, these defense establishments have been put on high alert. So I would like to ask the Honorable Minister, sir, to take necessary action and to give assurance that the department will take up this matter, not only with the defense, but at the ministry level, sir, and to also remove the gate.
Question number is finished. Now we come to the agenda.
Before we come,
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I want to raise a point of order on the Rule 300 of the Rules of Procedure and Conduct. Sir, it was a very lengthy question, and we all agree that the Honorable Chief Minister had to be on his feet for almost an hour to reply to the supplementaries. But let me draw your attention, sir, to start to Rule number 34. Rule number 34 clearly indicates that once a question has been posed, supplementaries can be raised by the honorable members from both sides of the aisle to a maximum of 5 supplementaries per person. Now, this may take an hour or a little less than an hour, but the rule clearly indicates. The Honorable Parliamentary Affairs Minister also said that they have spent enough time, and we understand that due to the gravity of the situation of the question and the importance of it, this has taken a very long time. But the Honorable Chief Minister has said that he has answered enough and would like to stop there. For that, sir, you will need to amend Rule 34, whereby the House, the Rules Committee, proposes that we cannot exceed more than so many supplementaries irrespective of the number of members who participate.
60 members.
That we have to amend. Otherwise, this is for the information of the House and for all of us, including myself, that the prerogative of the members to put questions is covered by this rule. That is my submission, sir, in this regard.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, point of order under Rule
300, again pertaining to Rule 34 of the Rules of Procedure and Conduct of Business. Now, this is the first time that a right of the member has been curtailed in this August House. I have not been allowed to give 5 supplementaries by the chair. That is unprecedented. And therefore,
chair's decision is final, sir. I think that's wrong on the LO to question your decision.
You are the judge. You are considered as infallible. So we will urge upon you to ensure that in spite of the interpretation to mislead the house, our rights may be always protected by the chair. That is my humble submission before you.
Deputy Speaker, sir, I would like to just react to what the Honorable LO and our Honorable MLA from Nongthumai just said. Well, sir, I did not refer to the rules, but as per convention, I'm talking about, as per convention, is it fair that one question we spend more than 1 hour or maybe more than 50 minutes, which I personally feel it is not fair. If that is the case, then why do you have to submit so many questions in the form of that question? This is what I wanted to clarify. That's why, sir, well, in the rules it is not there, of course it is not there, but my submission, my advice to the honorable members of this August House, especially to the honorable members from the opposition, kindly, once you see that the issue is so important, it takes time, you please come up, as per the provision of the rules, come up in the form of so many forms, where you can spend 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, if need be, we can extend hours. That's what I'm saying. So, sir, that's why I submit to you once again, sir, because we are not here, we are not here to break the law, the rules, we are not here to break the rules, but let us also strengthen the rules as much as possible, sir.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, sir, I think he referred to my submission just now, the Honourable Minister. Yes, it is right that we shouldn't take so long on the question, there's no doubt about that, but the rules allow it. And the Honourable Boundary Affairs Minister has said that it is the convention of the House not to go for long. The question is, sir, in the presence of a rule, how can convention be taken precedence? That's the point.
Your suggestion will be taken up in the Rules Committee.
Thank you.